Please welcome our last lightning talk speaker of the night, Bilgin Ibryam from Red Hat.
Hi, everybody. In this short talk, I want to look at Kubernetes from a user and developer point of view and share with you some ideas and suggestions what benefits it provides. So there are many definitions about cloud native. But if we look at cloud-native applications in practice, these are applications that are implemented following the principles of microservices. They typically run in containers orchestrated by platforms on top of cloud infrastructure. And if we follow this definition, there are many platforms actually do qualify as cloud-native today. And the interesting part is that this cloud-native platform, nowadays they offer common set of abstraction and primitives for developers to design, develop, and deploy their applications. Just to give you an example, for example, the concept of deployment unit, which is pod in Kubernetes, now exists in Apache Mesos. It exists in Amazon ECS under different names, but still offering the same features. So there are new primitives for developers to design and develop their applications. In this talk, I want to go quickly over 10 principles and patterns I'm trying to collect at the moment in this work in progress book. So very quickly, the very first fundamental prerequisite for an application to become a cloud native is to be observable. What I mean by that is the application has to provide, as a very minimum, endpoints for different kind of health checks. That's the first prerequisite. The second one is your application has to listen for events that are coming from the platform, and it has to conform to these events. An example here would be your application should shut down when it gets sick term, otherwise it will get sick kill. And actually, these two primitives then do enable the platform to do things like rolling deployments and fixed deployments, because now the platform can start your application. It knows when your application has started successfully. It knows how to stop your application. It knows whether your application has stopped successfully, et cetera, et cetera. And the next fundamental prerequisites would be to have a predictable resource profile. What I mean by that is you should see your application or Docker container not only as a box with all of its dependencies, but more like a multidimensional box which has at runtime memory dimension and CPU dimension, and you have to pass that information to the platform. So it can do things like dynamic placement, which means you don't have to think about placing a microservice on a single host or multiple microservices on a host. You just trust your scheduler to do the best placement for you. Next, I want to give you a few examples of behavioral patterns. Many microservices are API-driven, which means they have to do things like service discovery and load balancing. And in the traditional world, we had to do that as part of the application. So we needed an agent to register a service in the registry, another agent in the consumer service to look up the registry and call the service. In the cloud-native world, all that is still happening, but as part of the platform and outside of your application, which is the important part. Other type of microservices are not API-driven, but more time-driven or temporal. For example, you may have to copy a file at midnight from one location to another. Many of my customers have to do that. And typically, in the Java world, you have to use some kind of timer, or if you want it to be persisted, you have to use Quartz or Spring Patch. But that means in your application, you have to care about the actual business logic and also the scheduling. In the cloud-native world, all you have to do is just implement the file copying part and trust the platform to do the actual scheduling. Another example here would be the different kind of clustering requirements the services have. The simplest example probably for a cluster service is the singleton service, where you want an instance of a service to be running at all times. To do that, in Kubernetes, all you have to do is create a pod with one replica. In the traditional world, it's a pain. And another important point, all the topics we've discussed here so far actually now can be expressed as executable application manifest in a YAML file, basically. In the traditional world, all that knowledge would be scattered across different wiki pages, run books. Some of that knowledge would be in the head of developers. Some of that knowledge would be in the head of ops people. Now all that can be written down as an executable file from early stages and tested on all environments. In summary, here are the 3 points to take away. I would say let the platform automate all your routine tasks, such as placement, deployment, health checks, restarts, auto-scaling, et cetera, et cetera. And try to move as many NFRs or cross-functional requirements from the application layer down to the platform layer. Things such as service discovery, job management, config management shouldn't be a concern for developer. They should be just a given. And then you can actually allow your developers to focus more on the business process and actually create great domain-driven designs, beautiful APIs. Thank you.